evening, everyone. I'm Paul Jackson. I convene the Heritage Talks at Brisley. If you are not on the email list for Heritage and History Talks here, and you'd like to be, then please just fill in your name and your email address and I'll put you on the mailing list. Well, I really ought to thank everyone for coming tonight. It's great to see such a large turnout. When we come to questions, we'll be using microphones in the room. And for people watching online, if you'd like to ask your question in the chat box, we'll be monitoring that and asking it in the room. I'm going to hand over to Michael in a moment. First, on behalf of the Bath Royal Scientific and Literature Institute, can I say how pleased we are to be holding a joint event with the History of Bath Research Group here, and to enable David's talk to be broadcast on Zoom and available later on the Brisley website. I ought to mention that the Institute is about to celebrate its 200th anniversary this year, and this will be formally launched later this month. And the programme will involve more joint events with Bath organisations, which, like tonight's, will enable both organisations, both theirs and ours, to reach a wider audience. And details of that will be announced in the near future. And so to tonight's event, and at this point, I'll hand over to Dr. Michael Rowe, who chairs the History of Bath Research Group, to introduce David Crellin.
Thank you, Paul. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this lecture, which showcases an important piece of research carried out under the auspices of the History of Bath Research Group. I'm Dr. Michael Rowe. I've been chairman of the History of Bath Research Group for more years than is good for me. And the purpose of the organization is to do original research into the history of the city and to help the public access that and to support the City Archives in their work in making the archives also accessible to the public. David Crellin and Penny Gay, with the help of Mike Williams and various others, have undertaken this quite extraordinary piece of work over a number of years. John Wood and his son, John Wood the Younger, are well known. They're well talked about, but the fact that we didn't really know what they looked like has been an annoyance to historians and authors working on the history of Bath. But what these members of the group have done is turn that on its head and give us images of these crucial people in the history of Bath for the first time. It's very exciting work. There's more to do. Everybody's coming up with marvelous ideas now as to what these dedicated workers ought to do with their time. But I'm sure you will find David's talk absolutely enthralling. David.
Thank you. Well, thank you all very much for coming. I think some of you were in Swainswick Church on a very actually different evening from this one, which was the weather was quite, in one sense, auspicious, I think, in the sense that it get very atmospheric. And we had the sort of big reveal of these miniatures at that. And also, the miniatures were actually here with the family that owned them. The family that owned them were actually watching online, but they're at home in Italy. So the miniatures are also at home in Italy. So sadly, they are not with us. There are some large reproductions. And in fact, I have purchased myself a Peter Paul Lenz miniature, not of John Wood, sadly. But it gives you an idea of the scale of the actual thing itself. And when they brought them, I was reminded, because I went over to Florence to see them, and I was reminded how tiny they actually are. It is quite extraordinary how small these things are. But what I'm going to do now is to fill out on the talk I gave in Swainswick in October and explain some more detail around the discoveries, how we've got to where we are, and a little bit about how we go forward. But before I start the talk, I just want to play at least some of this video, which I hope will play, because this is the home that Bernardo was brought up in by his parents, and it was his grandmother's home, and his grandmother was Ada. And Ada features quite significantly later on, because she, the one we know, were left. But it's really quite ordinary Italian castle that goes down back medieval times. So again, I think it's rather remarkable that the pictures that we have now of John Wood and his son spent many years in this extraordinary location, which I think John Wood and his son would have rather enjoyed themselves. And of course, a location which is steeped in Italian history, which to some degree reflects on the whole development of the Palladian architecture, which the Woods came to espouse. I'll just let the video play through. I think it is rather a lovely thing. Right. So anyway, that's the sort of setting that we're working with. Now, it's important to start by actually just reflecting on why this whole thing is important. Bath is what it is because John Wood the Elder had a vision for Bath. And what we now know is that he was a son of Bath, and he created that vision at a very early age. And it is really important to realise that the city of Bath would not be nearly as significant if he hadn't had that vision and created the initial template for the city, which was then extended with more crescents and all of those sorts of things. So we really are indebted to the Woods for what we have here. And it's very important to reflect on that. So what I want to do initially is just to give you a little bit of background as to how this research started. I'd been worshipping at Swainswick Church for many years, actually. But in 2014, I sort of realised that the Woods were buried there. And I thought, oh, it would be a rather nice project to look at the descendants of John Wood. At that time, I thought the descendants sound interesting because I'd read quite a few books about John Wood, and nobody seemed to know an awful lot about them. I think it's also important to recognise that the family is likely to be the way you would find material relating to the family. And I definitely had a vision that there might be the possibility of discovering artifacts and maybe even pictures, because by then I was aware of the fact that there really was very little in the way of good imagery of either of the woods. And as the project developed, I actually relatively quickly managed to identify that there was this Italian strain in the family, this Italian set of descendants. I'm surprised myself that within 2 years I'd already made contact with the Blasi Foglietti family by using Facebook. And the name Blasi Foglietti is actually all but unique. There are, I think, a total number of about 6 members of the family alive today. So it was relatively easy to find them if they were online. And the daughter, as some of you will have seen her at Swainswick, she was online on Facebook, and I messaged her and said, "Are you by any chance?" And she said, "You need to talk to my mum." And that's the history of how we got to where we are in terms of knowing that part of the family. Relatively early on, Sally identified the fact that there was this scrapbook which Henry Brockwood had produced, who was a descendant. And that sounded very exciting, and certainly something that I wanted to go and have a look at and understand more about. COVID got in the way a bit, and as a result, it took some years before we were able to actually arrange visits. But it turned out the scrapbook wasn't the sort of central thing of this story, actually, and that'll become clear. And Penny joined me as a fellow researcher, and she really transformed our understanding of John Wood's ancestors as well. Which was something I didn't realise needed to be done, because I think we all thought we knew what the story was. Turns out we didn't, but a lot of the work on that was done by Penny. So let's just think a bit about what the proposed images of John Wood there have been. And these are 3 of them, and there are probably more. Reg Wright, who was he was actually head of archives, librarian. He's a bit responsible for some of these, because he was a bit fanciful, from what I understand, and he sort of thought any image that looked about the right time might have been John Wood. And at various points, the one on the far left is actually a guy called John Padmore. This is a picture that was owned by BRLSI. I think it still is, but it's actually now in the Victoria Art Gallery. And it's got a crane. And I think that's what made people think it might be John Wood. But it's actually by Van Diest, and it's identified as John Padmore. I don't have any doubt about that. In the middle is a picture that actually Penny and I have written an article about, which is of a guy called Thomas Prowse. This is actually from a thesis that was written in 1948 by Barbara Coates. But that again is understood. We now understand who it is, and it's not John Wood, even though there's a picture, he's got an image in front of him, which looks like it might be the circus, but it's something else. And he was an amateur architect as well. And then on the right-hand side, we've got a bust, which was claimed to be John Wood in an article in the Georgian Society journal. But it was quite a challenge to really make that work, because it's actually dated 1767, which is 13 years after John Wood died. They came up with some rather fanciful idea that this was from a death mask, and so therefore was made in 1767, 13 years after his death. And in fact, again, research has been done on that, and it's we now know that that's some other John Wood. So those are the people who aren't John Wood. But what we do have is something that's a little bit more credible, which is the picture that's in the Museum of Bath Architecture, which we can't visit at the moment, of course. But I think many people know it. And it's the one top right-hand corner. And it's got a pencil marking on the back, which says it is of the four Bath worthies, and it lists who they are. The origins of that picture are obscure. The painter is, the artist is obscure. But it, we know that some of the attributions of the people in the pictures, because we have pictures of them, we know they're right, particularly Ralph Allen. And so that looked much more credible. So we, it's reasonable to assume that that might well be John Wood. But in our researches, what Penny and I speculated about was that one of the things we'd found was that Henry Brock Wood left a will, and in his will, he left all of his pictures to his sister, Sydney, with the express desire that they should be handed to Ada when she was 21. And Ada is Bernardo's grandmother. So that's how the pictures ended up being owned by Bernardo. What happened in practice was that Bernardo and his wife came over to Bath at the end of 2022. And we showed them all over the city which their ancestor had helped to develop. And it really inspired them to get very interested in their family, actually. And in March of 2023, I received an email which had this image in it from Sally. And she basically said, this is a picture that, or picture frame with eight miniatures in it and a cameo in the center. Is it significant? Is it of interest? Because it came from Monte Cuto, the castle that we saw right at the beginning. It was hard not to get extraordinarily excited at this point, because it was immediately obvious that some of the pictures were from the 18th century and other ones dated to the middle of the 19th century. And it looked like a family. And it looked very much like it could well be Bernardo's family going back in time. But in order to work out what this actually was, we had to do a considerable amount of digging and research. This is the picture which we have now identified as being John Wood, the elder. It's a miniature by Peter Paul Lenz. This, as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, this is another miniature by Peter Paul Lenz, as I say, sadly not of John Wood. But his monogram is very, very distinctive. And I'll be saying a bit more about that in a few minutes. But this is definitively John Wood. And I think it's worth showing this comparison, because on the left-hand side is the four Bath worthies version of John Wood. And on the right-hand side is the miniature that was found in Italy. And I think everyone I've spoken to is fairly convinced they're the same person. One thing I did try doing today, which I think says quite a lot about technology and painting, actually, more than anything else, I did try doing an AI comparison and say, are they the same person? Actually, it said, no, they're not. But I think this reflects the fact that an artistic impression of somebody is not the same thing as a picture of somebody, more than they're not the same person. As I say, I think it's fairly evident that they're the same person. One of the things that Tim Mole and Amy Frost said when we were at Swainswick, which I think it's interesting how when you get a group of people together, you get good ideas. And they both noticed the fact that the jacket that this person is wearing looks remarkably similar. It may not be the same one, because maybe he went to the tailor and got four or five of them or whatever, but the dress code is very, very similar. So I think that in itself is quite an interesting comparative observation. And this is almost certainly John Wood the Younger. I say that with a slight caveat, because there's nothing about this picture that identifies who it is. It's just that the dating we got from Rosemary Harden for when this gentleman was wearing this jacket from the clothing is 1780, 2 years before John Wood the Younger died. And he's really the only person it could be from the family. And it seems almost incredible that you would have a set of eight miniatures with one random person who's not part of the family. So there are no other members of the family it could be. And that brings us on to aspects of the research that got us to where we are, because the scrapbook that Henry had created was intriguing. It said nothing about the Wood family, almost. It was devoted to his wife's family and to his mother's family, both of whom were English. His wife's family had the helpful surname of Smith, which is a disaster for any family historian, but incredible efforts by various people allowed us to identify members of her family. And we know from her will that she left portraits of her grandparents to her cousin, Amy Burgoyne. And through all of that, we were able to identify, in fact, we got a lot of support from Alex Kidson, who is the Romney expert. In her will, Fanny Wood, as she was, Naismith, says that these pictures are by Romney. In fact, the one of his grandmother is by Romney, although that isn't it. I'll explain that in a minute. But the one on the right is her grandfather, and it's by Gilbert Stuart. And because it's by Gilbert Stuart, any art historians in the room who really know their stuff will know that Gilbert Stuart was actually an American artist. He worked in the UK, in England, for a while, and then he got into a lot of debt, so he sort of left, and he wasn't able to do the one of Thomas Smith's wife, because he'd gone. So Romney was called in to do that. But finding these pictures was important because we needed to know these weren't the people we had in the miniatures, because they're all relatives who could be relevant. And because Henry Brockwood was so fascinated by his wife's family, we were concerned that the miniatures might be that side of the family rather than the Wood side of the family. But finding these pictures, the one on the right is actually in the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Alex Kidson found it for us. And then there's also Eliza Stysted, who married William Henry Wood. William Henry Wood was John Wood's great-grandson, or his second great-grandson, and he married a lady called Eliza Stysted. Very fortunately, her grandfather, there's a picture of a miniature that the Blasi Foglietti's have in their photo album, so we could also work out that it wasn't that miniature either. Where that miniature is, I have no idea. So let's just review the sort of timeline of what we think happened, and then I'll go into a bit more detail about this in a minute. We know that Peter Paul Lenz was in Bath in the late 1740s. We know that partly because Sue Sloman in her book recognizes that he was working in Bath at that time, but also there was a miniature of Thomas Attwood painted at a almost exactly that sort of time, 1747, I think. And that was in the Victoria Art Gallery. So there was the miniature we have by Peter Paul Lenz of John Wood, and there was one of Thomas Attwood, who was actually a work colleague, at least, of John Wood, possibly a friend, in the book that John Wood wrote about the Bristol Exchange. The early version of that book, which actually is in America, or a copy of it is in America, the only known copy of it, I think, he actually talks about Thomas Attwood and the fact that he was a plumber and had a pump which he wanted to install in Queen Square, was it? I think, I can't remember where he installed the pump, but... Right, yeah. Yeah. So John Wood and Thomas Attwood would work together, and it seems quite evident, really, that they sort of probably got together and said, oh, well, I know this guy called Peter Paul Lenz, he'll do us a picture. We'll get some miniatures done for us. So I think that's the origin of that. So that's how that picture came to be painted. Obviously, at some point around about 1780, a miniature was painted of John Wood the Younger. Attributions of the artist are ongoing piece of work. Maybe more news about that in the not too distant future. The miniatures would have been taken to Italy by Eliza Wood, who was the wife of John Brockwood. John Brockwood was the son of John Wood the Younger. He was born very much at the end of that family. His wife had 14 children. The first 12 were girls, and then they had two boys. So it's commitment to get to a boy, but eventually it worked. Not necessarily terribly successfully, in the sense that John Brockwood was not the best behaved individual in the world. Little bit more about that in a minute, but he was a naughty boy in a number of ways. But Eliza went with her children to Italy somewhere in the late 1820s, early 1830s. We then know that Henry Brockwood left his pictures to his niece, Ada, at the age of 21, when she got to the age of 21. And then in 2023, we received the email with the picture of the frame. So how did they get to Italy? Now, this is actually still pretty much of an open question. What we do know is that John Brockwood was the residuary legatee of his father. His father actually probably didn't leave any money at all. He left a lot of debt, certainly, and I suspect there was no money at all. But of course, there were all the goods and chattels. And we do know, because there was a sale in Christie's in 1795, that John Brockwood sold all of the books. We've got a list of all the books that would have been in his father's library, and quite a few other things as well, and some pictures, but there are no portraits mentioned. So any family portraits either stayed in the family somewhere or had disappeared by that point or were distributed around other bits of the family. but the Christie's sale didn't have any portraits in it. He lived with his wife. Eliza is the probable, almost certainly the lady at the bottom, the picture at the bottom, and a little bit more about her in a minute. But he lived at a house called Danny Greig. Bernardo, Sally and I went to Danny Greig, and that is, it's just been restored. It's a rather lovely Georgian house. It suffered a terrible fire, and the lady who's restored it has done an amazing job, but was very interested to hear the sort of that part of the story of John Brockwood living there with his family. We know that. But I think when John Brockwood went off with his mistress to live in Hull, my impression is, there's some evidence for this, that Eliza went and lived with her brother, Richard, who lived at Cortigolan, which is very nearby. They're all near Crickhowell. Cortigolan was destroyed, was burnt, and then bulldozed in the 1950s, I think. So it's no longer there. But that was her family home. And the miniatures, it's my view, were with Eliza and her family in this house for a while. Then they went off to Italy. Now, why they went off to Italy is an open question. We really don't understand that. But John Brockwood died in 1825. Eliza and her family and her children would have gone to Italy probably almost certainly after that. After he died, maybe at the time he died, because at that point her eldest son would have inherited the entailed estate and they would have become quite wealthy. And I think he must have been rather very different from his father, because I think he must have been very generous, because one thing we do have is a copy, sadly it's only a copy, of Eliza's passport, which is on the top right-hand corner. And that tells us where she was between about 1832 and 1836, because all the stamps from all the different bits of Italy, you had to get a stamp to go from one town to another in Italy at this time. It's stamped, there's two or three pages of this thing, and it's very hard to read, but you can actually work out exactly where she was during that period of time, because all the stamps are there, everything about her trip. Sometime before that, her second son, William Henry, married Eliza Stysted in Naples. Again, no idea how they ended up in Naples, why they married in Naples. Eliza Stysted's uncle lived in Florence with his wife, and his wife became very famous for entertaining everybody who was important. She was, I think, by all accounts, quite a pompous lady. So, you know, she liked entertaining the Duke and people like that. She didn't deal with anybody who was sort of less than royalty in the local area, really. And that might be relevant, but actual timings of some of these things is yet to be worked out. And then there's this remarkable event on the 24th of June, 1834, when Eliza, her five maids, because the passport is for her four daughters and five maids, they really weren't poor, traveling around Italy together. You can imagine the entourage, you know, this is two coaches worth, I think, isn't it, at least? So, you know, quite a thing going around, I suspect. And the whole family is at that double marriage of two of the daughters, because they all ended up signing different bits of the marriage certificate, all of them. So we have that rather wonderful document which shows that they were all there, all together, including the eldest son, even though he came back to live in England soon after that. Then in the disturbances in the 1850s, at the end of the 1850s in Italy, when really civil war, the Austrians were sort of losing their grip and Italy was beginning to think it wanted to become a country. And it was all quite disturbed. Lots and lots of English people left at that point. And two of the daughters with their husbands left Italy at that point. But William Henry, really importantly, William Henry and Eliza stayed. Eliza actually died in 1855, so she stayed for other reasons. But William Henry lived to a ripe old age in Florence, and as a result became much more integrated into the Italian society, and his children married Italians, or well, married a French lady, but lots of marriages with Italians, quite well-to-do Italians, Italian counts. And somewhere around about that time, William Henry would have thought of combining all these miniatures from the family together and putting them into a single frame. The frame's been dated for around about that time, 1850s. So that group was created at about that time. So let's say a little bit about Henry, Sidney, and Ada. Henry is the gentleman on the left-hand side. There's a caricature of him from the Italian press. We've had a discussion with Sally, actually, about what this really means, and I don't think she understands it. We certainly don't. It's in Italian. But it's quite an interesting caricature. He obviously was quite a character in the local area. But there's a lovely pencil drawing that the family's got of him in the middle. And then at the top, we've got Sidney, who's Henry's sister. And on the bottom right-hand side is Ada, who's obviously a very, very attractive lady. One of the sort of sad things we hear about from the family is that one of the family homes, and I mean, this family, they did own Montecuto. They don't anymore. That was sold some years ago. But they still own a number of properties around the Florence area. Sally's always talking to me about how they're managing the people who are renting their houses in Florence. But one of the houses that they still own that's been rebuilt was actually destroyed by the Germans in the war. And that was where Henry actually lived most of the time. And it's sad to think that that house might have contained family portraits, larger ones. Because perhaps that's where they were. But if they were there, they were destroyed in the war. Very fortunately, the miniatures were in Montecuto, and that was too difficult to get to. I don't think the Germans were very interested in that. So they survived. So these are all the people that we have miniatures of, or at least most of them, six of the miniatures here. These are the other six. And the attributions of who these are is still a little bit speculative, but based on dress and other things, the boy on the far left is almost certainly the elder of the John Brock Woods. He would have been 10 or 11 when his father died, and that looks like a contemporary picture with the one of John Wood the Younger. So that would probably be of him as a young boy. Certainly fits. The one next to that, we think, is probably the younger John Brock Wood. But that's probably the most speculative of the attributions that we've got. We've then got William Henry and his wife, Eliza, And those are photographs of them taken fairly contemporaneously, interestingly enough. And I think the likenesses can be seen, personally. And then two of the daughters, that's William's, two of William's sisters, and quite possibly the two who married together in Livorno in 1834. And we do have a picture of Marianne, who was the youngest daughter, who actually ended up in Canada, no, USA. She ended up in USA, and it seems quite likely that that is her younger version thereof as one of the miniatures. So just a family tree summary, just to keep people clear, because I mean, I find family trees really hard to get my mind around and remember, particularly when there are lots of generations. So we've got John Wood the elder, John Wood the younger, John Brock Wood, who was the sort of bit of a bad lot. He went and lived with his mistress up in Hull. He left his disposable estate to his illegitimate daughter. Most of it was entailed and so would have gone to his eldest son. John Brock Wood the younger, who married, didn't have any children, lived in Brighton for most of his life. William Henry, who is central to all of this, really, because he's the guy who lived in Italy almost all of his life, really, lived right through to 1896. So he died at the age of 93. He was very sturdy. And then I've mentioned Henry Brock Wood, who he didn't have any children. In fact, Sydney and her sister, Henrietta, the only two who had any children. Henrietta I'll come to in a minute. But Sydney married Marisol Lampugnani. Arda then married Count Monaldo Blasi Foglietti, and that's the Blasi Foglietti name coming into the family. And Catervo Kit was Bernardo's father, and we now you know, have Bernardo and his wife Sally. So just a little bit about work beyond the sort of study that we did in terms of attributions, the identification of the miniature by John Wood as Peter Paul Lenz from his monogram and so on. When we'd done as much work as we felt we could do, we consulted with Sue Sloman, who was, I think, overjoyed to see the work we'd done and was completely convinced that the work we'd done was authentic and that the attributions were authentic. Rosemary Harden was an enormous help in terms of dating the costumes and really the starting point for thinking who these people might be. Catherine Wall and her team at the Victoria Art Gallery helped us a lot with the attribution to Peter Paul Lenz and this missing miniature of Thomas Atwood. And then Penny has been my partner in all of this and outstanding researcher. And then Bernardo's cousin, who's rather older than him, who remembers Arda talking about them as the English family. That doesn't solve the whole problem because they're quite a bit of English families, but as you can see, we've looked at other English bits of the family and see no links. So I'm just going to finish up with a couple of points about what we do next. There's this rather wonderful book which we discovered only very recently called The Anglo-Florentines, and this is really a history of what was going on in Italy at this crucial time that I've talked about today. And what's interesting about it is that, well, for a start, these are all the references in the book which relate to the Wood family in one form or another. So there's quite a few to go through and work through. It points up all sorts of research that they've done, both in our national archives, but also there's something called the Mackay Archive in Florence, which is a series of diaries of a guy called John Mackay and his mother, basically charting social life in Florence from actually 1814 to 1860, but the relevant times for us are the 1830s, 1840s, 1850s. And Penny and I are hoping to go to Florence to go through that archive to see what there is that refers directly. I mean, for instance, John Mackay, you know, they had balls and all sorts of things, and apparently he wrote guest lists for all of these balls. So you probably find out where people were on many days of the week. So that's going to be quite an interesting exercise. I mentioned the Foreign Office records already, but John Brock Wood wrote some stuff which is in that archive we know. That's the younger John Brock Wood, about his time in Florence. And some of the diplomats who were in Florence were very well connected into all of this as well. So there may well be more stuff to discover there. It would be really nice to find the family of Sidney's sister, Henrietta, because she married another count, somebody or other, and moved to Milan. And it's just conceivable that they may have some family records for all we know. And then there's this lady, Gwyneth Martin, who kept in touch with the family for many years. I mean, Sally and Bernardo knew her. She was a fourth great-grandchild of John Wood. She didn't ever marry, but she studied the family in depth. And she was one of the very few people in the family that knew that John Wood and his son were relatives. And she talks in a letter about a box of 18th and 19th century letters that she had. And one is hoping that we might find those somewhere. That's proving hard, but we haven't given up yet. And we want to find out who the artist of John Wood the Younger is. And we're talking to Sue and other people about that all the time with ideas. Just some acknowledgements. I think we owe a huge debt of gratitude to the Blasi Foglietti family. They have been so supportive of everything we've done. And bringing the miniatures over for October was just extraordinary from our point of view. Rosemary Harden, I mentioned already, incredible support from these people. Catherine Wall too. Sue Sloman has been an amazing support. Alex Kidson, for instance, expert on Romney, gave any amount of time to try and work out who these Smiths were and where the pictures were and all that sort of thing. This lady, Ruth Frendo at Stationers Hall, who helped us with some other aspects of the Smith family. The Getty Foundation, for instance, finding those pictures was made much easier because they had a copy of the catalogue of the sale of them at Sutton Park, and willingly let us have a copy of that. And not least, in all of this, Michael, who has been an immense support to both Penny and I in all of this with advice. And then finally, Charles Brownell. Now, some of you might know of him because he wrote a thesis about John Wood for his PhD. And he has been the most lovely supporter of the work we've done. Some absolutely glorious comments that he's shared with us. He's Emeritus Professor of Architectural History at Virginia State University, I think. He's just been so lovely. And that's it.
David, thank you so much. This is the most extraordinary piece of work, which, as you can see, is still ongoing. Now, David is prepared to take questions. Paul and David Hall have roving microphones. So if you have a question, would you put up your hand, please? And one of them will bring a microphone to you.
Right.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Could you say something about why people had miniatures painted? You talked about John Wood and Thomas. I mean, it's a bit offhand that, you know, they thought they'd go and have the miniatures painted.
Yeah, but, I mean, I think it's interesting, isn't it? I'm not an expert on this, so anything I say you'll have to take with the appropriate pinch of salt. My understanding is, I mean, some of them, I think, are memorials. The one of John Wood has his hair in the back, which makes it more likely to have been a memorial. So when he died, relatively soon after that picture was painted, it would have been possibly painted from a larger picture as something to keep with you. And I've read about the fact that people who had loved ones in miniature used to wear them quite often around their breast, so that they had them with them. So I think there's quite a significant bit of that. There's actually a picture of Eliza, John Brock Wood's. I think that picture I showed you, actually, she's wearing something around her waist that could be a miniature. And it's just conceivable that that's one of them. You can't see, the picture isn't detailed enough. But I do believe that people wore them quite a lot. But actually, Michael, do you know more than I do about this?
They did wear them quite a lot. And they had often had wristbands made. They did wear them quite a lot, and had wristbands made, sometimes of hair, other times just a bit of Petersham ribbon, with tiny, tiny versions to have them with them all the time. That's quite apart from all the ones that were painted as love tokens and so on. But Bath was a great centre for the painting of portrait miniatures. And the Victoria Art Gallery has a substantial collection. There was a lady who had a vast collection of English miniatures and silhouettes of all sorts, who very generously left the Bath element of that collection to the city, and they are in the Victoria Art Gallery. There's some tremendous things.
One thing I should say, by the way, is that we do actually have, I think, four descendants of John Wood in the room. So I don't know. I don't know whether you want to identify yourself. Don't feel obliged to if you don't want to. But there are some around who are descendants of John Wood. So it's a great privilege to have you here. Thank you so much for coming. Are there any questions online? We post them online, I think, as well.
David, perhaps I missed something, but it seems to me that yes, you've identified the artist, but you still haven't got definite proof that's John Wood, have you? Am I being unkind? There doesn't seem to be definite proof.
I don't
proof.
Think that's true, because the family owns that picture. Mm. And what we have done is identify that there is nobody else it could be that the family would have a picture of from the 18th century. So I don't think that... And personally, I mean, anyone can always debate anything, actually, you know, but I don't think I'm in a my truth situation here. I think the evidence is overwhelming that the one of John Wood is John Wood. I think it's more debatable whether John Wood the Younger is John Wood the Younger. But again, if you look at the family tree, there is nobody else from the family who it could actually be. So why would the family have a set of miniatures which they put in a frame? And bearing in mind at the time it was done, they would have known who they all were. So they would have had a relevance to each other.
I think there are a couple of other little points to make. Miniatures, of course, were so very, very rarely labelled with the name of the sitter. It's one of the most annoying features of miniaturists. Portraits quite often have something written on them, but not miniatures. We're very lucky that the lens one actually has a monogram on it, apart from anything else. The second thing that I think, David, that you haven't mentioned is that there was a comment by someone about John Wood the Younger having a big notch in his chin.
Oh, yeah, I didn't get
and that chap's got a great big notch in his chin.
Yes, yes, there is the Ugly Face Club description, which you could spend some hours debating. And certainly there are significant elements of the John Wood the Younger picture which fit with the Ugly Face Club description. I think one of the difficulties with the Ugly Face Club description is that it's almost certainly a parody in a way of him anyway. So you're trying to fit, it's a bit like a word painted caricature, and it's quite hard to link precisely the elements in the description with the individual definitively, but they certainly fit. And there are, when you look at them a lot, I think there are quite a lot of features you can regard as being family likenesses. I mean, the notch in the chin is something that's very distinctive about both the picture of John Wood the Younger and also William Henry. So they both got the same facial feature. But, you know, that again is not, there's no proof in that, but it's helpful.
So you didn't really mention what professions these descendants had, or did they just marry into wealthy families?
John Brockwood the Elder actually inherited a vast fortune when he was very young. It probably didn't do him any good in the sense that I think it sort of allowed him to misbehave, perhaps, shall I say. One of the things that he managed to do was to lose £1,000, which at that time was quite a lot of money, because he promised to marry a lady and then got sued for not marrying her, and he married Eliza instead. So that fortune that he inherited from his uncle, I don't think, in a sense, helped him in life in some ways. He certainly wouldn't have had any kind of profession at all because he didn't need to. And similarly, I think his eldest son probably didn't need to. William Henry is referred to as a banker, but also as a wine merchant and various other things in Italy. So he did work and did have sort of jobs. And then William Henry's children, the girls certainly married extraordinarily well into very wealthy Italian families. So I don't think, again, they needed a lot of additional support.
Well, I'll ask a question. In that miniature of John Wood the Younger, he doesn't appear to be wearing a wig. Was that common at that time?
Well, actually, this is something we have had a discussion about. And again, I definitely say I'm not the expert. But yeah, I think it's about the time when wigs started to go out of fashion. His hair's powdered, I think, so he's grayed by powder rather than being gray necessarily. And certainly, intriguingly, the hair in the back of the miniature is not gray, so the background to that is another interesting aspect. But I, as I understand it, you know, that's about the sort of time when wigs started to become less fashionable.
You hadn't mentioned the hair. You hadn't mentioned the hair.
The hair, what's in the back of the miniature?
Back of the miniature, yes.
Yeah, yeah. So John Wood's miniature has his, well, presumably his hair in the back of it, and the one of Eliza Stysted, who married William Henry, they both have hair in the back. And they both died certainly quite young and arguably unexpectedly, perhaps. And so that might be an explanation of why their hair is there as a memorial to them after they died.
Is there any potential for doing a DNA?
I've looked at that. I mean, for a start, you've got to open the miniatures, which is not something we're planning to do anytime soon. And I wouldn't recommend it to the family. But also, having looked at it, and in fact, I have had some conversations with Turi King about what's possible and what isn't. The technology is not quite there at the moment, I think, is the general consensus. Although Bernardo has done a DNA test, so it'll be interesting to see what comes out of that.
What have you got planned as your next steps?
Next steps? Well, I think this trip to Florence to look at the Mackay archive will be one of the higher priorities. There is a lot more work to do. I mean, definitely there's stuff on identification of artists of some of the miniatures. It's not just the one of John Wood the Younger. There's another one which is actually signed, but we've not got anywhere really with deciphering who the signature is of John Brock, what we think is John Brock Wood the Younger. Is that it? Any other questions? Were there any questions online?
No. No, I checked. I couldn't see any online.
Right. Well, I think we're done.
I think there's one other thing I might say, ladies and gentlemen, is this is only a part of the extraordinarily extensive research that David and Penny have done into the woods and their background, working backwards from John Wood, the elder. There are still some gaps to fill in that, their origins in Devon. And from many authors, we've had aspersions cast on John Wood's use of coats of arms and crests and so on. And work has been done which has demonstrated, in fact, that those aspersions are ill-founded. He was, in fact, related to all the people that he thought he was, told other people he was related to. That work is all brand new work. The detail is there, published on the History of Bath Research Group website in a series of extensive papers by John, David and Penny Gay, and I would recommend those as a good long read for these cold winter nights. With that, ladies and gentlemen, I would thank David and the others who've done all of this work most sincerely for what they've done and for sharing it with us tonight.